Someone came up to me on the street today and asked me, "Sir, could you please tell me the date?" And I said, "Sure, it's July 16th, 2012. Made sure I included the year there. Indeed it is this very day, a Monday. And it feels like winter here in the Bay Area of California. Unbelievable. Really, I mean, it is cold, it is windy, it is cloudy, the light feels like winter. So, we're in the middle of summer, but it feels like winter. Amazing. And yet, no excuse to, we need to make the best of it. Where we are, make the most of it. Every video, I think, you know, this is the last one. It's so taxing. I think I've said enough. I've said it all. But then the next day comes and I say, well, I can do a little better. And that's pretty much the spiritual path. Path of the tortoise is, you know, the tortoise says, well, I can take maybe one more step. And so the tortoise takes one more step. And that's pretty much how it goes. And so today, we're going to take the step of sort of taking an overview to start out with. What has been presented here in these videos is an actual conceptual framework that is easily translatable into experiencing the living light, the overlay, the unconditional love, the real world. It's literally this conceptualization that is very clear, that can easily be translated. And that's the most you can do with concepts, the most you can do with reason, with thinking, with words, with explanations, with clarifications. All you can do is get close enough so that it's easily translatable into experiencing. That's it. That's the best we can do. So I feel I've done that. I feel like I've done the best I could do, best that can be done, really, in laying out the very, very clear case of what our reluctances are, the basic root that we struggle with, what everybody struggles with. And I can say everybody, because here in the Bay Area, we have people from all over the world, and everybody is in the same boat. Everyone is struggling with the ego's offer, the ego saying we can have something better than the identity that we can have right now. We're going to have something better. And the reason why we don't experience it right now is because we're making it better. And if we experienced our identity right now, we'd give up trying to make it better. So we're all struggling with this ego's offer, like that we're going to have a better identity. And so we all continue on with existence, and we reject the experiencing of our identity right now, what's available right now, as our identity. And that's pretty simple stuff. We also reject... Oh! A little bird just flew right in front of me. It's right there. Hello. That's the one that has a nest. And sort of take an intermediate step here to get into that nest that's right up above me here. Okay, there you go. So, and speaking of intermediate step, we need to take intermediate step. What these videos do is give us an intermediate step so that we realize there is a conceptual clarification that can take place. We can take it all the way up right to the threshold of experiencing, and then from there it's easily translatable. We can do it. It's been done. I've done it. I'm satisfied with it. We've carefully examined the ego's belief system, what we're doing, how we're deceiving ourselves, what's causing us so much reluctance and fear and resistance, causation, what's causing existence, what's sustaining existence. How do we let go of existence? How can we remember what we are? all this, all this key essential questions and concerns have been answered. I've gone over them over and over and over. So the next step should be, oh, a lot of birds are flying around right here for some reason. The next step should be experiencing it. A lot of people around the world at times have talked about a coming ascension. What they say is there's this galactic superwave, which many have been heard about. And they say that those who are attuned to this energy will literally be able to use this to energy to ascend. Oh, there's the other bird. Beautiful. Ruby red throat and crest. I've never seen a bird like that around here. Wow. Interesting. Huh. We'll be able to use that energy to ascend. To be translated, as it were, into light bodies or something such as that, or to relocate or something. It's going to be the boost. Well, that is possible. I'm not rejecting that out of hand. The important thing is to be ready to be translated into the living light, the problem-free world, the paradise, the nirvana, the transcendent, the kingdom of heaven, into a far, far greater situation, better situation, the loss-free world. Be prepared to be translated into that, and we prepare, we can conceptually get ready for that. Now, there may be one more additional step, some of which I have done, which is beginning to at least get a faint echo of experiencing of simply nonstop delight. Throughout your day, everything you see is just delightful, just delightful. Because in the real world, what we're being translated into is simply the experiencing of nonstop delight in what we're perceiving. The experience I had with the real world was a place that had the plants and the trees and the bushes and the flowers, the shrubs, landscape, and I saw some water like a ocean or a lagoon or lake, and I it's sort of a natural world like we're used to. But there were no buildings. I saw no buildings. I saw no roads. I saw no electrical poles. I saw no evidence of civilization, as it were. So what I found myself doing was just sitting on a rock very quietly, looking over this vista area with plants, and just looking at these plants and the beauty of it, and just saying, wow, these plants are incredible. Beautiful, flawless, just flawlessly beautiful, but still looking like n organic, natural, not like silk plants or fake plants. Noisy airplane. And I felt like what you do there is you simply take it all in. You can just sit there quietly, taking it in, or you can just walk, stroll around. I strolled around some, just walk, and just looking. Everything I saw was incredible, delightful. Plants, some of them were gigantic, like, and I looked at them carefully, and I realized that they're like timeless, like they've been there billions of years. And not, no sign of harm, no sign of death, decay, destruction, storms, accidents, nothing. Everything was like flawless. There's no loss. I didn't see any loss anywhere. So I just took this in. It was fantastic taking it in, like to say, oh, this is wonderful, 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 incredible. Loved it. I said, ah, this is what I want to see. So that's what you do in the real world. You simply allow, go allow this feeling, you feel this feeling of delight in what you are experiencing, what you're seeing. And it's a seamless delight, because everywhere you look, it's the same. It's not like you can go to some place and it's really terrible there. there's no place that's dark and destructive and terrible there. It's all beautiful. So we're getting ready for that. Now, conceptually, I think I've done enough. I can repeat it ad infinitum, but I've laid out a very, very clear, compelling case for the entire situation. So what's next on the docket, I believe, would be to go through a situation where there's a place of great beauty and everything seems to be very, very beautiful, and just sort of stroll through that. Now, that's the reason why I go to golf courses. I'm really practicing, getting close, trying to get close to the experience of the real world so I can easily be translated into that world. And, you know, lest we, you know, think that this is a weird, strange concept. No, it's not. Again, much of the New Age teachings and prophetic teachings and advanced spiritual teachings of this world are saying that there is this wave coming. There is this energetic something, vibration, something that is going to translate us into higher dimension, more DNA strands, light bodies, all sorts of different, you know, ideas of this translation. Rapture, you know, all these various things. And so it's a very common, actually, belief that somehow we're going to be translated into something vastly better very soon. End of 2012, probably into, you know, going into 2013. So I've been working on that for a long time, getting ready for that translation. I feel it will take place. So working conceptually, it's all very clear. And then working experientially here in this world to some extent. Now, how do you do that here? Well, there are various ways. I said, like, one of them is a beautiful golf course. And you're strolling along on these emerald green. Now, I've had some experiences that were pretty amazing. I had one experience where, in the desert, where they overseed the, they have two different types of grasses. In the summer, they have Bermuda grass, and then in the winter, they overseed it with a type of, a type of rye grass. And they keep everybody, all the carts off the fairway when they're doing the overseeding until the grass is grown in lush like a emerald green carpet. And I just happened to be there one day, the morning, which is the first morning that they allow carts onto the fairways. And so here I am driving out on this fairway, and it was immaculate, like an emerald carpet of living green grass, and the lakes were shimmering. Everything was just incredible. I mean, it really blew my mind, you know. And the whole course, there was no evidence of any play on it whatsoever, because no carts could be on the fairway, so they're all immaculate, and very few people had been playing it, because for a while they had actually closed the course for a month. And then when they open it, they allow cart path only. And then eventually you get to go on the fairway. So that morning was the first day on the fairways, and there had been very, very little play on that course. So it looked like it was immaculate. And we were out there, and it was just like nobody else around. And it was like, oh, did we die and go to heaven? Really? I mean, it felt like that. So that was a powerful, powerful experience. Of a faint echo of what the real world is like, where the real world, you walk the fairways of the real world, and you realize everything, all the plants, the beauty around you, has been there forever, at least from the standpoint of time. And there's never been any harm touch this place at all, and there never will be. That is the experience that you have, and that is just like a powerful beyond words. Endearing beyond words, and you just feel this gratitude and a wow factor. So the way to prepare for that is one of the ways is to stroll through beautiful places where everything just seems to be so lush and healthy. And now, I've talked about in other videos the possible lowering of the dimensions of this world splitting into various dimensional worlds. Not just one world, but several, maybe three worlds. Higher dimension, this one, and then a lower dimension. And in the lower dimension world I spoke about, there'd be enclaves there of the elite, or the aristocrats that will rule over the lower dimensional world. And in the aristocrats' enclaves, there will be these lush parks and golf courses and beautiful places, and they will use, you know, labor, slave labor, indentured servitude, whatever, to manicure everything, like in olden times. I mean, Gautama Buddha's birthplace, when his parents' home was a palace, and they had an army of gardeners and workers there, removing all traces of decay and death from that place, because they're terrified that Buddha would see some death and want to inquire into it. So they tried to, every morning, you know, early, all night long, they'd be working. In the morning time, you know, he got up to walk around the palace grounds and gardens, everything would look like immaculate. And the aristocrats do that. What they're trying to do is they're trying to tell those who live in the world, their subjects, those who they're using to serve their every whim, that their enclave is heaven on earth. And everybody who's there serving them in servitude should not inquire at all into any true heaven beyond this world. That their enclave is heaven, and therefore they should stay right where they are. that's what it is. These enclaves of country clubs and beautiful golf courses, etc., are used by the elites to try and give them authority over the planet they're on by saying, look at what. How everything is here, and compare it to how your garden is, and this area we live in must be divine. This must be heaven, and we're here by the divine right of God ruling over you. But the fact is, they have an army of gardeners, okay, agriculturists, and greenskeepers, and groundskeepers, and fertilizer, and the right. The right seeds, the right everything, so they can make it look incredibly lush and beautiful with, you know, artificial waterfalls and rivers and just, you know, like a paradise. And they can maintain it. And, you know, if anything starts to go bad, they can replace it like that. I've had experiences with those situations, actually. The elite, what they do overnight, they do most, a lot of the gardening is done at nighttime. So in the morning, it's just all the plants are there, like almost like God, you know, put them there for them. And what they do is they have greenhouses and nurseries, etc., that they use, that they bring in the plants from these greenhouses in pristine, beautiful, full bloom condition. And then at night they stick them in the ground, or they leave them in the 6-inch pots or whatever, 8-inch pots or 4-inch, and then cover them with bark, etc. But let's say they put them in the ground. And so in the morning time, you look and you went to sleep, there was a bed of flowers there or something, and you get in the morning, a bed of all new flowers, seasonal or whatever, in perfect condition. Hundreds of them, maybe thousands. I know down in the desert at the private country clubs, they bring in teams and teams of planters, and over one weekend they're able to completely change all the plantings in the entire country club area, the gated community there. And so, you know, you drive in after the weekend and you look, and everywhere you see is just beautiful plantings everywhere, and all the along the sidewalks, the dividers, all over the place, beautiful flowers, all looking totally fresh and healthy, you know, because they get them from the greenhouses in really great condition. And it really seems like you're living almost in heaven, you know, which is why, you know, those people, they live there because it gives you that, you know, illusion, can, and it's very intimidating to other people because they think, wow, you know, for some reason, this area, these people, there's no bugs, there's no sickness, there's no injuries, there's no disease. Their plants grow better, and in one day, you know, suddenly all the plants change, and the grass is always cut, you know. They don't, and there's no dead branches anywhere, there's no leaves anywhere. And what it is, like I said, is that you have these gardeners come in very early, and they manicure the whole place, pick up all the leaves, all the dead branches, trim everything, and they're working constantly behind the scenes to make it give the appearance that it's an immaculate place, and that somehow it's a blessed place, and therefore the people that live there must be blessed of God, and it must be their divine right then to rule over the rest of the people. That this is something that's been used on this planet from time immemorial. Okay. So, however, there is another way to use these places, and that would be consciously to use these places as a means to get closer to to getting ready to be translated into the true lossless realm. Okay, the true lossless realm, where everything is inherently loss. There is no gardeners at all, no upkeep whatsoever. Everything remains flawless. I'm gonna have to shift away here for just a little while, and you can meditate during that time on what's being said here. So those places can be utilized to be stroll through those places and use it to get ready to be translated. Okay, that helps boost you get this experience like, ah, oh, I'm walking among immaculate, beautiful nature, and it seems to be all perfect and flawless. There's nothing wrong with it, kind of. And it can be used to get ready to be actually translated instead of trying to lord it over other people as if somehow you're superior to them and you're living in some kind of special place in the world and everybody should bow to your authority. See, that's not the right way to use those places. But there is a right usage of those places. So just a second here, I'm gonna click away for just a second. Guess that worked. Okay. So, I've actually used those places in the right way and done some of that. And the enclaves of the very wealthy really should be used in that way by those who are getting ready for spiritual translation. Not, again, the way that they use them has been traditionally to make it seem as if somehow they're endowed with some divine authority to rule over the planet. But now it should be used to prepare for translation. And so let's see if that happens. You know, I can certainly do it, and if I do, I will certainly you know, report about it and do satsang and videos and show it. I don't know how helpful videos would be of it necessarily. I don't know. Maybe. I've tried some on golf course videos. The reason why I took video on golf courses was to show you kind of this flow, this seamless flow. I was going to the golf course through the whole golf course, showing you this flow with a video camera of just the beautiful fairways and the beautiful scenery and how to some, you know, tiny minor extent you might get this feeling like, yeah, that's like a faint sketch of what the real world is like, sort of a symbolic faint sketch of it. At least it plants the seed of that. And so put the two of those together. You put that type of experiencing along with the conceptual, both of those, and then you have a powerful preparation for translation. What we're really doing in this world now is preparation for translation. Some call it ascension, etc. Let's call it translation, to be translated into. I've called it relocation, etc. But it's more than that. It's a translation. It's a translation. And when we're ready, and those who are prepared, they'll say, it's no problem. Easily translated. Translation is there for everyone. But if you haven't prepared, you will see it as a threat. Because again, I remember I said that the main belief of the ego is transformation. Not translation, but transformation. That we can transform this world into the experience we really want. And I've said that's the fundamental delusion, the fundamental defense that keeps us bound to suffering. So in being translated into the loss-free world, we have to be willing to let go, to realize that this belief in transformation, we'll just let it go because it serves no purpose for us. We will say, oh, what could we possibly translate this loss-free world into except a place of loss, and we don't want to do that. No, we don't want to do that. So that belief has to go. So if we're still clinging to that belief, we won't be translated into that. We'll resist it. So some will be translated and some won't. That's in the Bible too. You talk about one stands in the field, one is taken, one is left in the field, so to speak. It's talking about translation into the kingdom of heaven, so to speak, or the lost free world. And some will be translated. I hope I am translated. I'm working on it. I can't say for sure, 100%. No, I don't know. Maybe I won't. Maybe I will. But I'm doing my best to prepare for it. And my intention is to be translated for sure. Always has been. And I encourage everyone else who feels like, that's what they want, to get with it. Because that's what's being spoken of here. It's preparation for that. Preparation for translation. And the reason why we keep clarifying and making more videos is because it's very, very difficult to speak clearly on these topics. Because there's enormous pressure not to. There's a consensual, self-censoring pressure that we've all been taught to not touch on certain subjects. And so we self-censor ourselves just out of this awareness of what culture and society wants from us. So it's super difficult to talk about these things just plainly, easily, and directly. And so each, satsang is an attempt to go even further, realizing that maybe tomorrow we'll need to do even better. Previous videos may not have been quite as clear, but you could see that there are step efforts in the right direction. Making right effort is crucial in this world. Don't expect perfect perfection right off the bat. Making right effort here in this world, right effort is all important, all important. The results sometimes they'll be there, sometimes they won't be there as much, and sometimes they'll really, really be there, really great. But if the right effort is there, you're doing fabulous job. And it's kind of like we stumble along here, really, because the resistance is so enormous, titanic, that we best we can do it like we're walking into a hurricane force winds and a fire hose is just shooting right at us, trying to blast us and drive us backwards. And kind of we have to put our heads down and just, keep going. People are pepper spraying us, we're just getting rubber bullets. It's like the riot police are there just saying, you must go back. You cannot go in this direction. All the defenses are battering us severely. So, it's like I say, I'm a battered performer. Battered life, for sure. Fought, thousands and thousands of battles against the defensiveness, which is trying to silence us all and keep us turned in the direction of darkness, delusion, self-aggrandizement, arrogance, futility, impossibility, and misery. It's trying to keep us in that direction. So turning away from that, you encounter severe headwinds going against the current, so to speak. So we just do the best we can, make right effort, and realize that, hey, it's probably going to be good enough. So these satsangs here are mostly dealing with clarification, bringing your clarification up to a point where it's more easily translatable into experiencing the real world, the lost free world, where you will realize, it's safe, it's okay to let go of the defenses, I don't need them here. And you'll be aware of that. You'll say, okay, I can set this aside, this baggage I don't need that and that and that, and you can sort through it all, and you say, all this stuff here, I don't need it, just, I'll set that down, don't need it. It won't be a panicky thing, you won't be screaming for your, clinging to your treasures like in hysteria and you know, just, no, you can be completely calm just like this. It's very important in a satsang to be calm and matter of fact, because that is the attitude we're getting towards. Even when someone says, when we feel like, okay, I'm setting down my belief in transformation, but just, okay, matter of fact, I've looked at it, know exactly what I'm doing here, and just set it down and remain calm. No franticness, no elation, no panic, no, you know, no throwing stuff in the air and going crazy and all that. Just, no, you know, just matter of fact. I've seen it. I've already looked at that. Okay, I've looked at that. I've already done the work. Work's been done. No need to make a big fuss of it at this point. No need for any fuss here. Okay, so that's one type of satsang. And there's the other, which is the flow of delight, of feeling that you're just, imagine just floating down a river and on the vistas, a panoramic vista of just beauty. Wherever you look, it's just this gorgeous beauty, immaculate beauty, and you're just floating down this river. And it's just, you just sit there in delight. What else is there? Don't need to comment on it, right? Because it's always going to be there. And you're always going to be there. You have the right to always be there if you want to. And so it's not like, you know, you need to, you know, take snapshots of it real, you know, wow, I got a picture here and here and here, and be obsessed with, you know, how do I capture this, and how do I write something about it, and how do I do this, and now you simply sit there, you know, maybe with some tea or some water, or some drink, and just relax, and very quietly just experience it, and you know you can come back. Same river, same route, and experience the same thing. And maybe you'll even experience a deeper level. Maybe each time it feels even more fabulous for you. But the whole situation is not shifting, it's not changing, there's not seasons like that. Wherever you go, you know you can return there as many times as you like, so you're not trying to shove it into memory. Okay, you don't need to remember it. You don't need to make a movie of it, take pictures of it, paint it, do anything except simply enjoy it. Take delight in it. Just take delight in it. And so just imagine going down a river for days and days and days. I wish I could take a video. I'm trying. You know, I'm trying to present to you that type of experience somehow, you know, by using video. It's not easy. And I put them over on another channel. I don't know if I should put them on this channel or another channel. I have a channel, Cool Down Place, that, you know, has some videos that try to just, like a take a train trip through lush, tropical, beautiful scenery. And you're just sitting there in the train, and you're just watching it all flow by. And you don't have to do anything. You're just sitting there, standing there. Just, I had a friend take some friend. Took video in India of some trips he did in Bangladesh, actually in India, Bangladesh, and very beautiful. I put those up on Cool Down Place. That's a channel on YouTube. Maybe I'll do some more, or somehow I want to get some videos up that give you the experience of this just flowing through this beauty, the light, just you not having to do anything except just sit there quietly and enjoy it. That's a powerful meditation, because it prepares you to be translated. If I have the opportunity, I will go to the most beautiful places, you know, on the planet, and take video for it. The best thing is to actually go there, you know. So if you have the opportunity for such a situation, you know, take it. Take it. And just, and again, I wish more people would put their material into Creative Commons so I could use it. And I keep searching for that, and maybe personally, maybe I'll have an opportunity to go somewhere where it's really, really beautiful and just take a lot of video and post those, you know, every day as much as possible so that we can all experience it, at least, you know, on video. It is, to some extent, it's helpful, really. Not as powerful as actually being there. But it does have some power, and to at least give you the idea, okay, that the experience you're going to be translated into is just this effortless experiencing of beauty. You don't need a ticket, all right? You don't need to pay for any ticket. You don't have to pay for food. You don't have to pay for anything. You're not going to be cold or hot. You're not going to be inconvenienced in any way. You're not going to get tired. All right, all this stuff, none of that. You simply feel in this optimally fresh condition and experiencing this beautiful flow of this, of immaculate nature, immaculate landscapes, immaculate beauty. And you know that it's untouched. It will never be harmed. It will never be changed. It's just flawlessly there for you. And you just say, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm just loving this. I'm just loving it. This is beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. And just enjoy it. That's it. Yeah, you know, you comment on it to someone else. They're saying, hey, did you see that? Because they're seeing the same thing. I mean, everybody there is having the same experience. I mean, they're the same delight. You know, it's not like we have to get together and share notes and do therapy or anything like that. No, this is the therapy. This is the real therapy. The real world has real therapy in that it reminds us of reality. There's no loss in reality. In reality, it's simply endless delight. Become multidimensional delight, but it's even beyond that. It's delight in every direction we want to experience it. Simultaneously, rich, 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 rich. Rich is beyond compare, beyond belief, really. If you just get a glimpse of it, you just say, huh, you cannot match that in existence, no way. You know, and no matter how you try to simulate it, it's like a difference between a vast pile of pure gold and a little tiny flake of fool's gold. You know, it's like that difference. You know, huge difference. So we're not trying to simulate it for the purpose of deceiving ourselves. What we're trying to do is we're trying to get some facsimile of it. What was that? Wow. What in the world was that noise? I don't know. We're trying to get some facsimile of it so that it's easier for us to be translated into that. That's the only reason. Right use, okay? Right use of situations. Whatever situation you're in, focus on right use of that situation, okay? It's all important. You can find a right use for almost every situation really here. Boy, I have no idea what that was. It's something came off the roof, just wow. Well, you know, if the living light wills it, it'll happen. I'll be able to present something, and maybe I'll go work this evening on trying to present something via video that gives you this feeling. So you might want to check out Cool Down Place on YouTube. Cool Down Place. And maybe I'll make another channel or something. I don't know. I'll figure it out. Or I could present the videos on this channel. I don't know. Maybe you can give me some ideas. What do you think would be the right thing to do? Hopefully we can get some of these videos going, because again, the white people on this planet are preparing for translation. Obviously, this planet is just verklempt. I mean, it is absolutely, the wheels are coming off in so many ways. And this isn't just some person who's getting older, you know, saying, oh, tut, the young generation, they're crazy, blah, blah, blah. No. So many, 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 many factors. The world has been dumbed down. And when it gets dumbed down, it becomes vulnerable to all sorts of mischief and wrong direction, and it just, the whole thing collapses. And people lose the capability to make right use of every situation. They make wrong use of it, you know. So it takes a lot of awareness, a lot of will, a lot of determination, just heart and spirit and love to make right use of situations. It really does. Really takes a lot from us. And if we don't give that effort, you know, we're not going to do it. So wherever we are, we have to make that effort to make right use of the situation, to prepare ourselves for translation. We've been doing that here conceptually. Those who have been watching these videos have got a full-on dose of the kind of conceptual clarifications that lend themselves very easily to translation into the real problem-free domain, where we're absolutely entitled to dwell there. Absolutely entitled. We live under God's rules. And only God's rules. Not the ones we made up. God's rules for creation. We're entitled to that because that's what we were created for. So we are entitled to prepare for that too. But be prepared conceptually, and we also need to prepare experientially. I used to, in years gone by, I would try to plant gardens that were just extremely beautiful, and then I just walk among those gardens. I actually have some video of those gardens. Maybe I can dig some of those up also. But I'd like to have something even more powerful than that, you know. Going to the poppy fields in Antelope Valley was amazing. Absolutely amazing. I have video of that, but it's, so in those situations, you don't necessarily have to use concepts when you're just viewing those videos. You just get in a state of mind like you're just, imagine that you're just moving through perfection. That is there forever, and it's just, as I said, I set the table, set the scene for you. That it's all there simply for your delight and for you to enjoy. And that's preparation for translation. I don't know how many, you know, are aware in this world, you know, make right use of time right now. That is right use of time. And if I get circumstances such that I'm able to do that, I certainly will do it. I've done a lot of work in the past on beautiful golf courses. I try to go to the most beautiful places on the most beautiful days in the past, and you know, try to take video, try to do something. It's difficult. It's not so easy, really. It's a lot of work, but it's doable. It is doable. Sometimes circumstances arrange themselves, so I've, you know, able to do. And myself, I've experienced, you know, some pretty amazing beauty. There are some very beautiful golf courses in the Bay Area, in the foothills and various seaside, etc. And you can at least get a feeling like you're in some higher domain there. And it's because, you know, for one thing, you don't have to do all the work to maintain the place, right? So if you like, oh, this is here maintenance free. That's not my worry. And of course, there's an army of maintenance people there. We're not overlooking that. And we're not trying to exploit that for our aggrandizement. We're trying to make right use of a situation that's already there and use that to get us ready to be translated into a domain where there's no maintenance work necessary. There's no slaves there. None. Zero. Zero slaves. There's nobody cutting or trimming or hauling trash or, planting or anything. Labor free. There's no labor there. There's no machines there either. None. Zero. There's no gadgets there. Zero. What do you need a gadget for? There's just this immaculate spread of nature that is just, that wows you. Really wows you. It's just there quietly, peacefully, serenely there just for you to enjoy. And it maintains itself. It's self-maintaining. It's a self-maintaining world. No gardening work, which is a fabulous thing because I'm so burned out on cleanup work and maintenance work and garden work, which I've had to do my whole life here. And just if I never have to do any more, I'll be happy. It's just such an incredible burden. I mean, look about now. The wind has been howling here, and there's just leaves everywhere. I mean, I have to literally clean up. You know, there's hours of cleanup. Every time the wind blows, there's hours of cleanup I have to do. Just horrible. I used to try to get this entire yard looking like perfect, immaculate grounds. No spider webs, no dead leaves. Everything fresh and green and sparkling and everything swept, everything blown off and swept so it looks pristine. I'd hose everything down. No, all the side of the houses, looked nice and completely clean and fresh. And I literally every day had to spend my time just desperately maintaining it. You know, I was trying to give myself some experience, like of living in a place where everything seemed to be take care of itself, except in this case, I had to take care of everything. That's too much work. Terrible. I hated the wind, Oh, gosh. Because I get everything immaculate, It was just so beautiful. And then overnight, the wind would come up, and I'd get in the morning, and it was just, branches and leaves and junk everywhere. And then, of course, plants would die, the insect problems, the snails would chew everything up, and the gophers would come and just, just an endless string, this invasion of spiders and spider webs. And it just never ended, the constant battle, to try and maintain an area that looks pristine is just, oh, it's horrible. But somehow on the golf courses, they have all this, big power equipment and there's ways to do it, ways to make it, give at least the illusion that it's maintenance free and all beautiful. And I've done that my whole entire life. I love to just go out on golf courses. I used to go out on one that there's nobody out on it, almost nobody, because the owners had given up on it and it just went wild. But in its time, it used to be gorgeous, just incredible trees everywhere. It was just fabulous. And they just let it go to pieces, absolutely go to pieces. So I used to go on there. And there's like nobody around, and I couldn't play very well. I just hack it around and lose a lot of balls, and but it was the strolling, it was the walking, and there was no cars. We just walked through there, and it was just like walking through this place, almost like timeless place. There's no people, and the trees were massive trees, and there was no maintenance crews, nobody there. But it was pretty ragged. I mean, it's pretty ragged. Your ball go off the fairway and it's lost, basically. But that was a very profound experience. And eventually they sold it and they bulldozed it. And I guess they probably built condominiums there, which was a shame. Because I could have gone there every day and just tried to stay in touch with this memory, of the real world. And, how idea that there's no pressure on you to do anything there. You just stroll or sit. And wherever you sit, fabulous, immaculate, beautiful perspectives surrounding you. Just, you're just sit there like stunned silence, how beautiful it is. Wherever you sit, wherever you go, it's all that you experience. There's no ugliness there. There's no death there. There's no loss there at all. Zero. None. And so these golf courses, they make them look like everything is there's no loss there, I mean, I remember back, like in Washington, D.C. recently, that derecho, that strong storm, they were playing an AT&T National at Congressional Country Club there, and the storm just knocked down trees everywhere, just tore the course apart. Dead, I mean, branches all over, strewn everywhere, leaves everywhere. It's horrible. They actually wouldn't allow spectators on the course on Saturday. It's too dangerous. But they had maintenance crews which worked around the clock. They brought in night lighting and they worked nonstop, cleaning everything up. And by the time Sunday rolled around, the storm was like on Friday. By the time Sunday rolled around, you could hardly notice anything had happened. They just still this. You could see this beautiful, immaculate golf course seem like so, it's like flawless, flawless. And yet there's this horrific storm. It just crashed through there, a day and a half earlier. So teams of workers with all the right power equipment and trucks, et cetera, are able to keep golf courses or various, places like that looking just, like they just came down with yesterday's rain, just fresh and dewy and lush and green, and everything's perfect. And you think, wow, am I on planet Earth? Am I really on planet Earth, or am I in some other dimension here? It kind of feels like that you've stepped into another dimension. And I was literally told, given the strong push by inner intuition and the living light, that I'm supposed to play golf. And I said, why should I play golf? I'm not interested in playing golf. And they said, you really need to do that. The feeling was, I need to do that. And because it'd be helpful. And so it turns out it has been helpful. The actual playing is a nuisance, really, because it's very difficult. And it's just one day you have it, the next day you don't, and no matter what you do, just something goes. You can't putt, you can't drive it. There's always some part of your game that's not so good. But the thing is, that's not the point. The point is to get out in these places as if you stepped into another dimension, and that gets you ready for translation. Because translation is really like simply driving your car to a golf course, getting out of the car, getting in your cart, and then just driving out on that emerald green course, and knowing you're going to be, out on this beautiful, sparkling place. Nobody's going to bother you. No demands on you, nothing. It's almost like that, really. Translation is that you just simply, it's like, okay, here we go. I'm going to be playing this golf course now for quite some time and just enjoying it. So there is some similarity to that. Where in this world you can go from, all the stress and suffering and misery and pressures and all this stuff, and you drive to the golf course, you put your bag on the cart, you get on the cart, get on the first tee, boom, off you go in the fairway, and you somehow it's like you're in another dimension. All those problems, et cetera, have vanished somehow, vanished. Of course, when you finish, go back to your life, they're all there again. So that's a difference. But there is some similarity to it. So I hope I can do that. I mean, I can. I should be able to handle the golf side of it, pretty decently. Good enough to, keep the ball in front of me, basically. Just keep kicking the ball down the fairway and kicking it in the hole and just keep it in front of you. That's basically, what you have to do. Just keep it in front of you. Don't keep it to the side of you. Keep it in front of you. Keep the ball in front of you, and you do okay, and you get around. And so, I hope that that can happen. I don't know. Maybe it won't. Maybe it won't happen. Who knows? I don't have any necessary clue or about it. I don't have the means to pull it off at this point. But it might happen. Again. Try to find some way to make this available in video format, and so that at least people can, who want to get ready for translation, can feel that. And somehow I need to reach out to people a little bit more, maybe on YouTube, and invite them in here. And, you know, but I need to make it clear what it is that's being worked on here. Maybe some people don't want to work on translation, which is fine. You know, they'll stay in this world, or perhaps their vibration will shift into the fourth dimension, or down to a lower vibration, higher vibration world, a lower vibration world, instead of being translated into the lost free world. It's okay. It's all okay. Reality is never threatened by anything that happens. Any dreams, dreams don't threaten reality. The laws of God, reality, identity, everything remains the same, is unthreatened, endlessly unthreatened. So any delay is just delay. Doesn't change the fact that everyone eventually will experience the lost free world. Everyone will. That's the intermediate step, the halfway house back to reality, back to accepting, full acceptance of reality. In other words, dropping our denial of reality completely. We need kind of a half house to, after this horrible, horrible experience of imprisonment in this nightmare, we need a halfway house where we kind of get back to delight. So let's see what I can do. Let's see what happens. I used to make a lot of videos, and maybe I can do better. If you know, I'll put some up and see if some people, if we can't gradually get some watching base of subscribers who enjoy watching these videos, being conscious of what it is we're doing. I think we're at the point now where we're getting more conscious. You know, I'm getting more conscious. You're getting more conscious. Is that way? We're getting clearer. We're conscious that we're practicing getting ready for translation. That's what we're doing. We're getting conceptually clear. We're getting experientially prepped for translation. See? So, prayers for some means to carry this out. Some way, somehow, the means come about so I'm able to do this and make it available. And I'd love to do that. Okay. So for now, we'll end this video. It's already been like an hour, which is pretty amazing. I feel like I could go on for longer, but I've got to spare you the 2.5 hour videos for right now. Maybe I can work on something tonight, like I said, and put it up with some explanation. Okay. Very great. That's it for this video.